So, here we have the Aurora Dashcam from Auto-Vox. Let's open her up and see what's inside the box. Sliding the top off the box, let's see what we're greeted with. Ah, manuals. So, thank you for choosing our dashcam. And inside this little envelope, we've got our manuals. They are available in English and German and French. Underneath those, we've got the thank you for choosing our product leaflet and a little bit about how you can register information. And below that, we have the plastic covers that go on the windscreen. So that's the peel label. And you start there and you peel it off. That's what the image shows there. That's where the GPS mount for the camera goes once it's stuck on your windscreen. That's just reminding you to peel the adhesive on the GPS mount. And that one shows you where to put it next to your mirror in the car. So obviously, that's the GPS section. That's where the camera goes. Right, next up, the camera itself. So let's just take that out of the box. And see what else we've got in here. And remove the protective packaging. And underneath, we're greeted with what looks like the power supply, some cable clips, and a pry tool. Right, so in a little bag here, we've got some cable clips in case you can't pry the trim off, and a couple of sticky pads for the GPS mount for the camera. Useful little pry tool helps you open up the gaps in your trim and push the cable in, hide that along the way. Next, we've got the power supply. Let's see if we can get into the bag without tearing it. No, that's gonna rip. Oh well, there we go. Open that up then. Okay. So we've got a micro USB mount, 90 degree. Relatively straightforward, lots of cameras use these nowadays. And a dual 2-amp power supply. And I say dual because one of the feeds is for the camera and the other one's for the USB slot on the top for your sat-nav or whatever. Very useful. Right, let's take a look at the camera. Let's just peel off the lens cover protector. And what we have here is a 3-megapixel, 170-degree f1.8 lens. That's just a grill on the side of the camera for air. On the back here, the getting started protective cover. I'll just peel that off. Okay, and what we have here is a 2-inch colour screen, not a touchscreen though. And the rear view lens, which is 150 degrees f1.8 again, and the IR illuminator. Looking at the top, what we have here, that's the GPS sensor. If we undo this little knurled ring here, that gives you the adjustment. So when the camera's on your windscreen, you can adjust the angle. No tilt though. And then you can do up the knurled ring to just tighten it. It's a bit fiddly, but it can be tight enough to keep the camera steady. Then on the underside here, we have the reset button, which is recessed, and the 4 menu buttons for the main camera menus. On this side of the camera, we have the micro SD card slot, the microphone, and lastly, the power button at the top here. And this is the GPS antenna we spoke about earlier. That has to be on the clear section of your windscreen, not under the window tint. As a quick resume then, this is what you get in the box. Camera, the GPS mount, the power lead, the clips, and the cable pry tool. Moving outside to the car, you can see my existing Nextbase 522 already installed. And next to that, right about there, we're going to put the Aurora so that I can do a comparison. There's that label I showed you earlier. What we're going to do is peel this bit here. Once you've done that, hold it up to the position of where you want to put it, and mine's going to be up here next to the camera, and stick it on there. So we're going to peel this, take that label there, ease that off like that. And then what we're going to do is stick the sticky side up on the windscreen up there. Change the camera angle, and there you go. Place it next to the existing camera for me, and try and get as many of the bubbles out as possible. Just rub it in situ, make sure it's stuck on firmly, and give it another rub down with the cloth as well. Right, so here's our camera and GPS mount. There's the connection for power and for the GPS antenna there, and there on the mount. And there's that little sticky adhesive pad you saw me fix earlier. I'll just undo this knurled ring again. So make sure we get the right angle for the camera. Should be somewhere about there. Stick that back in there like that. Magnetic attachment. It's easy to remove when you need to. And we're just going to take that adhesive label off, and we're going to mount that up there to the GPS square that's shown on that label, like that, and then press firmly, make sure it's on properly. This is roughly how it should look when you do yours. Now you've got, as we mentioned earlier, tilt adjustment, but there's no angle adjustment. So you can't go left, right, you can't twist it at all. It's only forwards and backwards, and that's because it's stuck on the windscreen there. Next up, let's plug the power lead in, and then using the cable pry, run it around the car, and then tuck it in and plug it in. Next up, camera into the GPS mount like that. Make sure it's clicked in firmly. Moving outside, you can see the installation is not as clean as the next base. That clear label really is an eyesore to me. And that mount really could be, well, it really could be better off as an adhesive suction mount like the next base, to be honest. Much more adjustment if they'd done that. Let's take these two cameras out on the road, and I shall do some road tests for you, and you can do some video comparisons for yourself. So we're about two car lengths from the car in front, so for comparison you should be able to see what the difference is between the two lenses. The Aurora does appear to be a wider angle lens than the Nextbase 522. You can see if you zoom in a bit what the quality is like. Currently on 1440p. He didn't look. There we go. Currently on 1440p on both cameras. Just drive through the centre of Ross. And I'll switch the audio between the Nextbase and the Aurora, so you can see what the difference is between the two whilst I'm driving. So this is the maximum quality setting, 1440p. At 30 frames per second, which actually should be the same resolution as the next base. We'll see how it holds up in the final edit. Looking at the screen, which is noticeably smaller on the Aurora, the colours do seem more muted, but that might just be the screen, so I'll need to check the final record and actually see what's come out on the video. Right, let's go up the bypass. Still in the 40 zone at the moment. Let's see what the engine sounds like drop it down a couple. That's 70. Right, let's go up the bypass. Still in the 40 zone at the moment. Let's see what the engine sounds like. Drop it down a couple. The Aurora is now in dual cam display, so it's 1080p front and back and 30 frames a second. Just gonna drive through town again so we can see what's going on. Check out the number plate on the car in front at 1080p as opposed to 1440p in the previous clip.
As you can see, switching to 1080p from 1440p gives a noticeable reduction in the quality. As we drive up through the centre of Ross here, you can see that the Aurora has a darker image. It's probably down to the fact that the lenses are f1.8 as opposed to the next base, which is a 1.6. The colours, though, much more vibrant on the next base. But then, that said, the next base has the sky is pretty much blown out. With the Aurora, you can see a lot of the cloud detail. But when you go into the darker sections, the Aurora doesn't show quite as much detail in the arches. So the contrast ratio and the actual exposure range on the next base is obviously much better. It is a more expensive camera, though. The Aurora here doing a good job of showing a lot of detail in the whites. Clearly on the bank there, you can see a lot of the detail on the bricks. Some of it appears to be missed by the next base, but the Aurora are doing pretty well, actually, for its price range. And again, as we come to a stop at the top of town here, look at the detail in the cloud, the Aurora picking it up, the next base completely blown it out.
So here's an example in a reasonably well-lit street. Street lights, Christmas lights, shop lights. Here's an example in a reasonably well lit street, but it's only the street lights here.
Interestingly, it appears to now be the Aurora that is overexposed. The sky's almost blue, not black, and the colours of the grass and the detail of the wall now appear to be much more saturated.
Here's the example on the dual carriageway. Logically, only the headlights here. But lots of other traffic.
Again, you can see the overexposed sections in the headlights and the sky from the Aurora. Night vision does sort of make it a bit easier to see any recorded events, but logically any detail will get blown out.
For comparison, here's a unlit country road using main beam. And there's dipped beam. Beam again and dip beam.
In conclusion, then, for the £112 asking price, I think the GPS mount lets it down. It really needed a suction mount with a swivel ball and socket joint, if you ask me. The mic quality is okay, but it's not brilliant. The video resolution is good, but wide contrast differences in what the camera sees means the exposure isn't always right, despite the claim of wide dynamic range. Maybe a firmware tweak could fix that, though. Overall, not bad for the money, but I was hoping for more at this price point. Hope my honest review has helped you. Feel free to drop a like and a comment below if you can, and I'll see you guys in the next one. Thanks for watching.